let go of your hate.
Your defeat is inevitable. Your compassion will be your undoing.
Hey guys, and welcome back to Battlefront Updates. Today I've got a pretty helpful video for both old and new players, as I'll be going over 30 tips and tricks that I've collected during the 140 hours I've played this game so far. The list will be mixed with some very basic stuff that most players might know already, but it will also contain some lesser known tips that will hopefully aid the most experienced player. So without any specific order, let's get straight into it. In Star Wars Battlefront, the accuracy of the blasters are not affected by your movement or if you zoom in, meaning that you are better off trying to move as much as possible and hip firing in order to become a harder target to hit. The only time it's worth zooming in is if they are actually at a significant range where you can barely see the enemy. If you play in third person, you get a lot better view of the surroundings and you can see around corners that you wouldn't be able to do in first person. It is also possible to switch from which shoulder you see the third person perspective, meaning that you can use this to your advantage on the battlefield to peek around corners on both sides. You can switch sides on PC by pressing C or by tapping down on the D-pad on the consoles. There are some situations where being in first person can be beneficial though. Two examples are when you're sniping, as it will mean that you won't accidentally hit any obstacles that can be hard to see in third person. And the second time it's helpful is when you're flying a ship and want to do a strafe run. Spotting enemies on the ground can be hard, and switching to first person makes it a little bit easier. When you're playing as the lightsaber wielding heroes Luke and Vader, you can actually turn off your lightsaber with the same button that is used to switch third person sights when playing as infantry. In some game modes like Battles or Walker Assault, you can actually see the hero on the map, so it doesn't make a huge difference. But in Hero Hunt, you don't show up on the map if you stand still, and being able to turn off your lightsaber can be the difference between life and death, as it makes a huge difference if you're in a dark room. Are you playing Walker Assault and got another one of those annoying blaster cannons that you just want to throw away? Well, don't. If you put it on the uplink like this, it will actually make it a lot harder for the enemy to activate or deactivate it, as they will often mount the blaster cannon instead, since the same button is used to mount turrets as to deactivate or activate uplinks. It's a sneaky little trick that could very well give you the extra time you need to win. If you play battles with AI, you can actually control how they're going to act. It's a little bit quirky, but the controls are binded to the same buttons as the emotes, meaning that the first emote means follow me, at which the AI will stay close and protect you, and if you use your second emote, they will search and destroy instead. They don't seem to be that smart, but if you mess around, you'll see that they act a bit differently depending on which command you use. If you want to play a specific map, you can actually hover over a specific game mode and a little select map button will appear in the bottom left corner. It's easy to miss, but great to know about if you have a specific favorite map that you want to play. Han Solo's Lucky Shot is extremely effective against ships. You might know that it actually one-shots fighters, but something that not everyone realizes is that it has a very heavy lock-on. Just shoot in the general direction of the ship and you're almost guaranteed a kill. Just look at the very heavy turn that this shot does and kills the TIE fighter. When you're capturing a uplink, droid, drop pod or any other objective, you don't need to stand still while doing so, but you can actually run around in a quite large area and shoot at the same time without cancelling the capture. If you're having troubles with turrets, the easiest way to counter them is to use Ion Shot. This charge card isn't super effective against vehicles like the AT-ST, but if you use something like the T-21B and Ion Shot, you can literally kill turrets and turbo lasers in 3 shots. The enemy does usually not even have time to react and jump out, but it will land you a safe kill. If you have trait level 3 with the Bounty Hunter trait, your star cards will recharge instantly whenever you get a kill. This is how people jump around with seemingly unlimited bowcaster and jump packs, which can be very annoying. It's also a great combination with star cards like the Pulse Cannon, as you can kill enemy after enemy from a safe distance without having to wait for the cooldown, as long as you hit your target. If you combine the CA-87, also known as the shotgun, with the Focus Fire charge card, it will fire long range slugs instead of short range bursts with a quite big spread. They can be quite tricky to hit with, but as you can see, they can take out enemies at a fairly long range in one hit, which is not possible to do without the Focus Fire star card. If you get yourself a squad shield, it can be very effective to use in combination with a blaster cannon or E-Web. If you place it down at the correct spot, the shield will protect you from taking any damage, but will allow the front of the weapon to be outside so that you can shoot out from the inside of the shield without being vulnerable to damage. Be careful though, cycler rifles and grenades can still penetrate the shield and kill you. Many of you probably know that you can jump on top of the sand crawler on the small Tatooine map. It's a pretty popular camping spot in the smaller game modes, as you often see people up there. But another sand crawler that I pretty much never see someone on top of is the one on the Tatooine Walker Assault and Supremacy map. In order to get up there, you first need to jump up here on the side and go into the out of bounds zone, and then use your jump pack from this exact spot. If you do it too early or too late, you won't reach the top, so it can be a little bit tricky at first. It's a great spot to use in order to defend the uplink if you're a rebel, as you can easily take those out that try to flank you from the right. Use your partner spawn as much as possible. This is obviously better if you play with a friend who you can communicate with, but more than often it's good to use as much as you can. In many game modes such as Walker Assault, you spawn very far away from the uplinks, especially as the Empire, so if you spawn on your partner, that can significantly reduce the time it takes for you to get to the objectives. We usually talk on Skype, and if one of us dies, the other one jumps in behind cover so that we can respawn back into the battle, because it's only possible to partner spawn if your friend isn't in combat. However, if your friend is playing as a hero, you can always spawn on him no matter if he's in combat or not. This can be both an advantage and disadvantage, and if you don't communicate, you might end up dying as soon as you spawn. If you only walk and jump, you won't show up on the enemy's radar. This is very good to keep in mind whenever you're trying to flank the enemy, as if you start running, you will immediately show up on the enemy's radar, making you an easy target to take out. However, if you use the scout trait, you will remain invisible even when sprinting at trait level 1. And at trait level 2, you will actually remain invisible even when shooting. So if you know that you will be doing a lot of flanking, the scout trait can be too much help. Even though the cycler rifle has been nerfed since the beta, it can still be useful as it's able to penetrate all shields in the game. This can be helpful as a lot of people inside shields may think that they are safe, and you'll be able to surprise them with a cycler shot to the head. This is also one of the few ways to counter the personal shield if you aren't in range for melee. If you play as Leia, she also has an ability that allows her to penetrate shields, which is the Trooper Bane. Whenever Trooper Bane is activated, she one-shots all infantry and stuns enemy heroes, and the shots will also travel through her own advanced shield, which can be used to your advantage a lot. Don't underestimate Darth Vader's Force Choke. I see this ability being neglected a lot. Often when I see Vader, I'm able to turn around and run away, which shouldn't be the case. The Force Choke has a lot longer range than you might imagine, and since it's also able to catch people in air, even those who jump back away will be an easy target for you. And due to its short cooldown, you should make sure to spam it as soon as it's off cooldown. The Smoke Grenade may be one of the most underused star cards in the game. The Smoke Grenade doesn't just block the view, but it removes all lock-ons from homing shots, turrets, and droids, making it a very good defense if you're pushed back by a lot of lock-on weapons and power-ups. If you place them very well, you can actually block the rebels from firing lock-on weapons like the Ion Torpedo on the AT-ATs. Both the AT-AT and the AT-STs have weak spots, which should be used as much as possible. The belly of the AT-AT that looks a little bit like a tube is the weak spot, and if you hit it, you will do double damage, so it's important to make use of it. If you're shooting at the AT-AT from the front, you can still hit the weak spot by aiming at this specific spot. The AT-ST has a weak spot in the back, where you also do double damage, meaning that if you hit a smart rocket on there, you can practically kill it in one shot. But that is easier said than done. Keep that in mind though, as it can be the difference between life and death. On the other side of the AT-ST, there's one tip I can give you, which is that you can instantly exit the vehicle at any time. I often see people getting killed in the AT-ST when they have just a few percent HP left, and if they knew that they could exit, they probably should have done so, as it means that you won't die and have to respawn all the way in the back. I usually stay in the AT-ST until I have about 20% health left and hear a lock-on, at which point I will exit immediately. You might have seen the lightsaber clash occur a few times between Luke and Vader. The way that this is activated is actually if both heroes perform the heavy attack at the same time. When the two heroes lock into the saber clash, you simply need to spam the attack button, and whoever wins the fight will knock back the enemy and get the upper hand for the next hit. The Ion Grenade is another very powerful tool against vehicles. It kills most turrets in one shot and does a lot of damage to AT-STs. It's triggered based on proximity, meaning that if you just get your Ion Grenade fairly close to the AT-ST, it will trigger and do a lot of damage. I think it does more damage than the Ion Torpedo, but as a trade-off, it obviously doesn't have as long range. Most of you probably know that if you press the reload button when your weapon is overheated and the indicator is within the yellow area, it will instantly flush your overheat so that you can shoot again. However, when you do this, the yellow area becomes smaller, and for each successful cooling flush without dying, it will become even smaller. This means that you shouldn't always use the cooldown flash. If you just killed an enemy and your weapon overheated, don't perform a cooling flash unless you have more enemies to kill, as that will only make it harder to hit the area the next time, which might just be the town where you really needed it. If you have a power-up and want to replace it with a new power-up, hero pickup, or vehicle, you don't need to throw the old one away, but you can simply hold E on PC, Square on PS4, or X on Xbox One to replace your old one without having to put it down. If you're using a charged up weapon such as the Bowcaster or Pulse Cannon, you can actually cancel the charge up without using the shot by switching back to your main weapon. This means that you won't have to waste those shots if your enemy dives down behind cover or something like that. If you're having problems with the homing shot, the easiest way to dodge them is simply to quickly run sideways and jump when the homing shot is almost at you, and you'll be almost guaranteed to survive. Combining burst weapons such as the SE-14C and EE-3 with the explosive shot creates a very powerful combination that can melt the enemies very quickly, and it also gives them a lot longer effective range than usually, as the explosive shot damage doesn't seem to wear off with distance as the normal firepower does. So that brings this list of tips and tricks to an end. I hope that those of you who are new to the game learn some very needed basics, and that those of you who have played the game a lot still learn some tips and tricks that you can make use of in the game. Please let me know in the comments below what you thought about the tips and tricks, and if you have any yourself that you want to share with the community. If you're new to the channel, don't forget to subscribe for more Star Wars Battlefront content. I will see you guys soon again, and as always, may the Force be with you.